a confused leader can never inspire. You need confident leader to inspire people, right? Some people, and typically more middle management or junior people, need more direction on how do they plan, how do they envisage, what are the markets they need to go, what are the things that they need to, you know, prepare for, and give them more ownership, more responsibilities. That also, you know, people then become more, you know, they feel part of the plan, and then that's how kind of positively impacts their productivity. And in all the matrix, Rohit, I also feel, and we did speak, you know, it's all about the psychological safety. You know, people cannot perform on their optimum performance until and unless they feel that there is a safe working environment for them.
Hello everyone, welcome to Curiosulus Chronicles podcast. This is your host Rohit Gautam. Apologies, I have a little bit of cold today, I've been under the weather, but the show must go on. So I'm here with a new episode with Sulbha Rai. She is Chief People Officer at RenewBuy. We will be discussing effectiveness of leadership in the VUCA world and its impact on people, a great topic to talk about. Before we start, I would like to thank Abhyuda Global Co Circle for their support. And if you are looking for some programs to learn about professional coaching, please do reach out to them. A new level one course is actually starting end of this month. And most importantly, thanks every one of you for subscribing to this channel and liking and sharing and commenting. And if you are the first timer coming onto this space, listening or watching this episode, please do subscribe, like and share and comment your thoughts. It would be greatly appreciated. My goal is to reach 5,000 subscribers by end of this year. So please help me to reach 5,000 subscribers by subscribing to this podcast on YouTube. Thank you very much. And let's crack on with the episode. Welcome, Sulbha. Welcome to Curiosulus Chronicles podcast.
Thank you, Rohit. Very happy to be here and talking to you on one of my favorite topics. So really excited.
Yeah, thank you very much for accepting this invitation. And like you said, it's your favorite topic, effectiveness of leadership in the VUCA world and its impact on people. And you as a chief people officer, could you introduce a little bit your background to our audience, please?
Sure. So hi guys, this is Sulbha. I'm the chief people officer at a company called RenewBuy.com. We are an insurtech player. Been with the organization for 7 years now, and literally my second stint in terms of a job. I have worked in EY for almost like a decade, been an entrepreneur, and this is the third organization, so to say, and doesn't feel like a job to me because it just is an extension of my entrepreneurial journey. So yeah, that's been a great journey so far.
Thank you. So Sulbha, VUCA, right? Everyone knows VUCA, what VUCA is. What do you think, how it affects leadership today?
So I think, Rohit, VUCA itself, while people know this term for many years now, but I think it is extremely difficult for leaders these days because not only it affects them at a business front, but it also impacts them personally. When there is so much of volatility, uncertainty, ambiguity, leaders are constantly working towards remaining relevant. And to thrive in such an uncertain environment, they're continuously, preparing themselves to anticipate trends, the economic environment, the fast changing expectations of the customers, their own people, and even stakeholders. So it impacts a lot when it comes to their own adaptability, their own agility. They have to now learn to deal with not the perfect information, sometimes incomplete information, and then make decisions based on that. So again, that kind of impacts a lot. And they have to continuously work towards preparing what if, the different scenarios that may happen because of the challenges of the VUCA world. And in all of this uncertainty, there is also a strong need to involve people to ensure that there is a lot of, you know, collaboration and alignment happening. And that's when I think for leaders, it impacts their own resilience, how they are able to, how much grit do they have to sustain. And even at a personal level, I think it impacts a lot because they're continuously in search of answers because, you know, uncertainty leaves that kind of questions for them, and they're, you know, continuously working on those. They have to be completely vigilant, proactive. They have to continuously work on themselves. So at a personal level also, there's lots that leaders need to do because, like I said, to remain effective, relevant, there's a lot that needs to be done on the self. And that also means that they have to be in the best shape of being physically, mentally, emotionally, you know, fit. So I think these are some of the challenges that affects the leadership today, considering the VUCA environment.
Such a massive challenges, isn't it? And if you see that leaders today have so much to take in, and this is why, you know, there's no one way to go about it. They have to think a lot at the moment, right? Like you said, self is very, very important. Their personal life is very important in this world as well, not only the work life. I can see that that's why leaders are coming up in new day and age nowadays, it's really tough. And some leave, some stay, some show, like you mentioned, like, you know, show resilience, you know, and learn and then move on, you know. So obviously, you know, all the effectiveness of leadership is directly impacted employees. So, you know, what do you think? How does this effectiveness in this VUCA world, what's the impact it's on employees and their well-beings?
A lot. If I have to say, you know, and I've been saying this at multiple places, that, you know, no matter how much AI or how much technology comes, it will always be people who will be at the center of the business, because they will be the one who will be creating new AIs, new better forms of AI, right? And without people, businesses won't exist. So hence, the impact of, you know, on people will be immense. And when you're talking about the VUCA world and keeping that as a center, one thing that comes to my mind is a confused leader can never inspire. You need confident leader to inspire people, right? And for a leader to be confident, to be effective, I think they have to drive people. They have to understand their nervousness, because while leaders are more prepared, not every employee or every people in the organization is. So understanding their nervousness and then responding to them is extremely important. And again, when you're specifically talking about the impact upon employees on their well-being, I think effectiveness of a leader is seen when they are able to exude confidence and make people feel more important and feel that they are being taken care of. So that's an important role of a leader there. And to be able to do that, to be able to demonstrate that confidence and to be able to navigate the situation, the person, the leader needs to, you know, demonstrate rich caliber. And not only in terms of managing the business side of it, but also taking care of the people, you know, having trust in them, having more candid conversations with them. And while there would be challenges that leaders would be sharing, and that's important for the leaders to communicate to their people, it is equally important that they are also sharing the plan of action. Because just a challenge without the roadmap, without further information, will confuse people even more. And hence, when you share that openly with people, involve them, make them part of the plan, and that's when they kind of get excited. Then they feel, yes, they are part of it. Then they embrace the challenge, and then they are working along. So, you know, trust is the foundation. You have to believe in your people. You have to believe in their intent and give them support to pick up things. And this goes a long way in navigating through the VUCA environment. So to be more effective and to take care of people, most important is your communication skills, the way you're communicating your team members. It is extremely important that you continuously sharpen your communication, be extremely transparent with your people, because people can see through you, right? And the more honest you are, the more relatable you become to your people. And that's when you will, bring that trust element there. And you need to prepare your people. You know, while you have communicated the challenges, you have talked about what you want to achieve, but how do they navigate through the situation? It is all about preparing your people. And it's not about just the formal structures, etc., but how do you kind of involve them, give them the experience, not just functionally, but behaviorally, through tough times, how do you prepare them? So, we say that army who sweats in peace sheds less in war. So, it's very important that you are preparing, and it should not happen just one certain day, you hear something, some regulatory change or some massive changes, and then you're wondering what is happening. I think preparing your people both functionally and behaviorally is important, and that a leader should do. And make acceptance of change or embracement of change a part of your culture. And that can happen through various ways. And you have to make it, you have to normalize in the manner that changes are not bad always. They bring a lot of opportunities for people to grow, not only vertically, laterally. So there is, and even for the organization, a change could actually be a great business opportunity for them. So it's how do you see the glass, half full or half empty? That's about embracing the change. And like I said, when you're preparing your people for the change, you need to trust in their abilities also. So both goes hand in hand. While people need to trust the leaders need to trust their people in their abilities. While they may not have a past experience of handling a situation which they have never faced, but believing in them, in their innate abilities, kind of help again, navigate such an environment. And even, encouraging them to think differently, kind of again, building this like a part of the culture, creating platforms where people can share ideas, experiment, be part of the problem. So all this is our must have, or, you need to create that kind of enabling and supporting platform structures, culture for leaders to, manage their people. That would be my few suggestions.
Thank you very much, Sulbha. I'm going to pick up one thing you just mentioned, right? Regarding inclusion, right? So including people, employees with the change, like what is happening, include them. So this is, I think it's Timothy Clark's four stages of psychological safety is, and first stage is the inclusion, right? So once people are feeling included, the psychological safety starts, the trust starts, so it builds up in that. So this is why I totally agree. It's very important to bring people in at the start rather than telling them, this is the changes we are doing, right? So it needs to work both ways. So thank you very much. You mentioned the challenges, right? In your experience, what are some specific challenges leaders face in managing people? I shouldn't say managing, leading people under volatile or uncertain conditions.
Yeah. So I think one of the biggest challenge that leaders face is, when there is uncertainty, when there are, ambiguity, and leaders have to lead the organization. There is no escape for them. They have to take the organization to a next level. They have to show growth. They have to show, how the organization is progressing. And when there is not enough clarity, and the first challenge for the leader is, first of all, how to explain that what is required of them, keeping them excited and motivated to deal with such complexity or ambiguity. I think that's a very big challenge. Just knowing that the goalpost has changed, or just knowing that new things need to be done. But then how do you really excite them? How do you really motivate them? Yeah, this is good. We need to do it. We can make it happen. So that's one challenge. Aligning the overall objective of the organization with people's own interest and aspiration is a challenge, because while leader looks at it in totality, sometimes people, and at different levels, will have a different lens, and they need to see the changes that are happening in the organization. How does it impact me? How does it relate to my own aspirations? Are my own goals, personal goals, getting fulfilled or not? So that kind of alignment becomes a challenge for the leader. And when we are talking about, the different changes that are happening in the organization, it could be anything, maybe some technological change, some structural change, could be a merger or an acquisition, or anything like that. So how do you ensure that people around you, people working with you, are embracing this positively? That becomes important. And VUCA changes also bring a lot of excess workload that can also lead to people feeling a little burnout or overwhelmed. Then how do you handle that? That becomes something that leaders need to address. And when you are navigating this phase of change, how are you still ensuring that people are thinking creatively, they are innovating, they're looking for better ways of doing things? You can't always be the only person giving the ideas, and you can't be the only person giving the direction. You want more people to be involved, and that has to continue, and that can sometimes be a challenge. I also feel sometimes if there is too much of a change or a certainty, if you're not clear with the communication and everything is well explained, it can also lead to miscommunication, and that can have a huge pitfall. So, that can be a major challenge for leaders to kind of ensure that the real essence is getting communicated and not, with any added or wrong information going to the people, because that can again lead to a lot of, issues, people issues internally in the organization. But any which way is facing a lot of external challenges, you don't want to deal with such a thing. So, yeah, these can be some challenges, and leaders should be mindful of it, think through it, and then, have a plan of action around these.
Yeah. You mentioned a lot of challenges here, Sulbha. So I'm curious now, obviously that will impact employees a lot, right, with these challenges. All the changes happen, internally or by external reasons. How can leaders then support employees' mental health and resilience in such an environment? There are a lot of changes happening, a lot of uncertainty there.
Yeah, and I think this has become one of the important focus areas for a lot of leaders. Last few years, we have seen that leaders across levels, departments are conscious of the, impact of such a thing on their people. And again, I can't, emphasize less on effective communication of leaders, because, this is one skill which is so important for people to ensure that they care, and they need to communicate. It can't be a single department's job, ensure that they are safe. Everybody needs to, accept and ensure and tell people that they are important, and we care for you, and then create a more, infrastructure around it. And as leaders, they need to normalize mental health concerns. We can't say no. I mean, we don't. I have seen sometimes people may, not appreciate how can the person feel so stressed. This is normal. This has to be done. Sometimes people need to, and leaders specifically need to normalize this. And have a lot of access to things like employee assistance programs. These are, these days are available. There are many platforms available for people to reach out, seek help, because it becomes tough for individuals, and everyone doesn't have the same caliber. Everybody doesn't, you know, has the same level of resilience or you know, patience or abilities to handle tough situations. So, and everybody's personal situations are also different. So one needs to really understand and then help create some support networks. Again, important. A lot of times the nervousness or so to say, you know, things that impact employees, that they feel that they are not relevant, they will become irrelevant. How will they then survive in an organization? And to be able to address that, I think the upskilling, cross-skilling also needs to happen so that, you know, people see that organizations, the leaders are supporting people. They don't want them to be redundant. They want them, and that's again, a, you know, an indication that they care for your people and they are working to ensure that they continue to remain relevant. That reduces their anxiety, you know, of uncertainty, and then show them the possibilities that exist within the organization. Like I said, vertical, lateral, you know, then all these things really help people to become more sure of the leaders that they are caring. And then once, and it's a two-way street, you know, if people feel safe, people feel cared, they, you know, give it back to the organization. They give it back to the leaders also.
Yeah, true. And I can see these the changes happening are quite volatile, uncertain sometimes, right? So people, and then mostly what I see is my experience is, you know, the level of engagement is really low sometimes during those changes, you know. And that got me thinking, like, what strategies then leaders can employ to maintain those high levels of engagement or productivity among the organization during the times of uncertainty?
So engagement and productivity, I have different approaches both.
Right.
Engagement is more about the connect. Engagement is more about conversations. It also means that it's not only about hearing just the views of the top leaders and just getting the information. It is also about having more access to, you know, then further helping them decode the message. It's not only about just a decision made or just a change made. People want to know the genesis of it. People want to know the rationale behind it. People also want to know what happens next. So engagement builds confidence, builds trust. So hence, more channels of communication needs to be there. There should be a forum where, you know, it's not only top-down information flows. It is information exchange happening because people have questions. Like we have been just talking about such uncertainties. So people want answers. And the access is not there, they will have their own interpretation and it may not be the right interpretation. Hence, So I think for engagement, it is important that people communicate the rationale behind it. The plan also, if they have thought about it, how will they navigate through it, give more specific information and have more two-way communication where even employees can ask. And not all employees are confident and they can just speak. So have multiple channels maybe, you know. Sometimes it is important that there should be a forum where people can just pose their questions and then it can be responded by the leaders, you know, even through an email or through a chat. Nowadays, a lot of modes of communication are available within the organization. So I think I correlate engagement with more clear, frequent, two-way communication. Is that how I would like to put it? For productivity, I think one needs to be more specific because when you're talking about the changes, the need that the new goalpost maybe or the new expectation, then it also breaks down. It's not just about the what. People also now want to know what's the how of it. because just saying that, you know, our goalpost has changed, we have to achieve, instead of ABC, we have to achieve XYZ by so and so date. That again, people first don't understand where this is coming from, and they also want to know some sense of direction from the leader. How will this happen? Have you even thought about it? What's your plan? So I think productivity directly impacts on when the leaders are able to articulate the how part of it. And when you're creating the new, maybe new goals, define the goalpost. What I mean by that is, while we may have some, you know, medium term or a long term goal, but can you just chunk it, slice it for people to make it more digestible? In the sense, you know, all of a sudden when you're at a zero and you say you have to reach 100, sometimes it becomes unfathomable for the people. They freak out thinking, oh my God, even is this even achievable or not? So maybe just give them, you know, give them a more bite size or goalposts, buy this, this much, buy this, this much. So that becomes more achievable in their own mindset. And hence that can impact productivity in a positive manner. And again, I think I've been talking about when there is a change, when there is a new goalpost, and productivity can be only improved if you're investing in your people, right? It is important that they are prepared for the new challenges. And not always it is necessary that you go through a structured program or a classroom program. Lot of learning happens on the job. Are you then creating more cross-team collaboration? Are you helping people to work on some live projects? Are you giving them some pilots for them to see quick early success and then implement it at a larger scale? And give them more ownership, more responsibilities. That also, you know, people then become more, you know, they feel part of the plan, and then that's how kind of positively impacts their productivity. And in all the matrix, Rohit, I also feel, and we did speak, you know, it's all about the psychological safety. You know, people cannot perform on their optimum performance until and unless they feel that there is a safe working environment for them. So if leaders can work towards where failures are not criticized, but learnings are celebrated. You know, it just then gives them a lot of confidence that if they take up a new challenge, if they take up a new assignment, and unfortunately they fail, they will not be out of the organization, right? So, you know, there is still a chance of them picking up, surviving and thriving, because that's not the end of all, right? And where experiments are allowed, autonomy is provided and ownership is given, all these things add to a good psychologically safe work environment. This plays a long you know, way, and helps in a long run in helping in ensuring that people are highly productive. And I think we, being in the HR fraternity, we have seen, you know, so many reports which says when people are engaged, they are highly productive, and all the engagement and productivity happens when they know that they are at the right place and this place values them. So I think that would be my answer to ensuring high productivity.
So Sulbha, how can leaders then balance the need for quick decision-making, you know, especially with the need to consider the impact on their people?
Great question, actually, Rohit. And I have a few thoughts on this and few practices that I have personally seen work wonderfully well. First is, I totally love reverse engineering. So rather than creating, you know, thinking of a decision and then thinking of what we need to do to make it successful, just do the reverse engineering. Think that this is what it is we have to do, and what all will lead to failure of this plan. When you start thinking in this direction, that what are the possible reasons that this plan will fail, or you know, what are the possible pitfalls of this plan, you start then also relating the impact that it will have on people. And then what it happens, that as a human mind, whether you like it or not, we are more geared towards looking at the danger. We are more geared towards looking, finding faults rather than appreciating goodness, right? So when you start doing the reverse engineering for, any decision that you need to make, why this decision will fail or why this decision will lead to not expected results, you automatically start looking at the pitfalls and also start thinking about the impact on its people. Then you're better prepared of the impact of the decision on the people. So I think that's a great way of, balancing the need of making quick decision, because like I said, we are geared to look at faults first. So that comes quickly and you'll be able to do. Second is like data drives good decisions. So as much data leaders can get hold of, that's very important. And that will help leaders take quick decisions. And also with good quality data, they will also be able to see the impact on people. So that's, I think, again, a very, important thing that I feel that you should be consider. And also tried and tested decision making models. Why not? Because that's what the research is all about. They have been, done and tried and tested. Leaders should adopt, depending on the industry, the setup, the kind of decision that they are taking. And if they can adopt to some of the decision making models, I think that will kind of help them, make more pragmatic, more, effective decision. And if nothing else works, leaders should feel totally comfortable seeking help, consulting. And they are not gods and everyone needs help. So, reach out to mentors, experts. It's always a good idea to reach out to someone who has more experience, knows, been there, done that. And it always helps. So, these things can really help leaders in making quick decisions while also considering the impact on people.
Yeah. Thank you, Sulbha. Something came up when you said consult, right? Get help, right? And rather than just my experience, rather than spending so much money on external consultancies, like big consultancies, like, I don't want to name, but you know the word, big consultancies are, I would say, ask people inside your organization, because they have more information, how the change should happen. Or like I think you mentioned earlier, like involve them, right? They know better than anyone coming from outside to understand what's happening here and what decisions they need to make. So they can get help from, their employees, their people.
Absolutely, because they are more connected to the ground.
Exactly.
A lot of times, some decisions made in the boardroom will be very different than the ground reality.
Exactly,
so
probably
involving them and asking them is just a great idea.
Yeah, thank you. Curious, you mentioned regarding, the how. The leaders sometimes need to share the how. I think that in my mind, the thinking is that that probably depends on the probably level of competence if they're doing one-to-one. Right, or they're doing with the team as well, because you have to have like a situation leadership here to see, okay, do I need to coach the team? Do I need to tell the how? Because great leaders I've known is basically they show the vision, they show the direction, and let the team do like to find out the how need to achieve it. They actually show the direction. So I'm quite curious when you mentioned the how, what do you mean by that how? How is it? I'm just curious on this.
So, I mean, how doesn't always need to be giving them a step-by-step procedure, I think. And again, different strokes for different folks, Rohit here. People maybe at a senior levels may require more of a coaching and let them define and, come out with their how. But you need to ask the right question. You need to instigate that thought in them. And you need to take them to that direction of line of thought, right? Some people, and typically more middle management or junior people, need more direction on how do they plan, how do they envisage, what are the markets they need to go, what are the things that they need to, prepare for. And some other administratively, the things that needs to be done to get to the new goalposts. So that is the how part of it. And again, it depends on the level of people you are interacting Sometimes you need to be more direct. Sometimes, so you know, you may use coaching. Sometimes you may use mentoring, yeah, and sometimes mentoring, you may use directing.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, yeah.
So again, different strokes for different folks. One approach may not fit all.
Yeah, yeah. I think this is why it's important to know. Like, leaders now need to have, like, servant leadership, situation leadership, a lot of stances of leadership to actually, you know, be a good to great leader. You know, we call it like rather than a good leader, to be a great leader, you need to be quite kind of adaptive, I should say, you know, that you can't just go one size doesn't fit all. Like, and you said different stroke for different folks. So, I'm quite curious now, Sulbha. You mentioned the transparent communication, right? And the importance of it, right? So what are the best practices that you can recommend to leaders to achieve this?
Best practices to achieve effective communication?
Transparent communication, yeah.
I think just be authentic. That is what it all needs. You know, people, you know, can see through you, like I said, and to be really, you know, transparent in your communication, be authentic, give the right information, the true information to people. People working with you are assume that they're mature and they will handle things. So, you know, that's important, because when you're authentic in your communication, you also then come across as somebody who's a dependable leader whom they can trust, right? And that is again very important for leaders to be able to further ensure that they are transparent and their messages are being communicated the way they want it to be. You have to again have multiple channels of communication, as I was mentioning earlier, because that again increases engagement, that gives the opportunity for people to ask, check for understanding. So checking for understanding is again a very important thing that they need to do to ensure that there is a transparent communication. And it should also involve a lot of collaboration, because transparency is again a two-way street. When you are sharing the information, and again understand that you're taking the inputs, sharing it back, collecting feedback, all that is important. And to ensure that transparency is there and there is a continuity of it, ensure there is the good frequency of, you know, the communication happens, because some people may get left out. Some people may understand half bit of it. How do you then ensure that, you know, again, the essence, the message is reaching to the right, to all the people correctly? So you may, you know, need to have multiple times you need to communicate to people. And transparency is not only about you sharing your view, it is also about taking feedback from people and then listening to them. It's not just about like a tick in the box that, okay, you have taken feedback. Listening to them and actively listening to them is very important to build that transparent culture. So take that feedback. I'm not saying that every feedback needs to be incorporated, but actively listening to the point of view and responding to that is extremely important. Again, it's all about, you know, in the spirit of making it, you know, transparent to people, and so that the people understand it. And don't use too many jargons. I think transparent communication also means make it simple. Simpler, you know, the simple it is easy to understand. Don't use mumbo jumbo jargons. People don't understand it. And also, brevity is important. We keep saying, you know, it's not about the length of the communication. It is just about the essence of the communication that is important. The messaging is important. If we're able to be sharp, concise, it's going to stay with people. You know, people don't remember a lot of, words or the long sentences that you say. I think they just remember the essence, the message. So the sharper you are, the better it is. And in spirit of transparent communication, I also feel it should be more personalized. People should see it as your message, more personalized message, and not just because you're head of some organization and because you hold some title and that's when you're talking to them. Because again, you need to bond and connect with your people. What is the whole purpose of communicating? That you want something to do differently, or you want them to be aligned to you to get something done, right? And you alone as leaders, they will not be able to do until unless everyone comes together, agrees, and, you know, says, yes, we are there with you and we'll do. So, you know, a personalized message or, you know, personal style of communication goes a long way in building that up. Yeah, I think these things kind of help. And I did mention about the feedback. Yeah. So, yeah, listening to your people is important in that sense.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you, Sulbha. Thanks for this wonderful discussion. Unfortunately, we are end of our time for this podcast. I have a final question on this. It's been in my head since we started, actually. So how does emotional intelligence, you know, we all talk about emotional intelligence for leaders and for probably everyone, right? Because everyone is a leader in the organization. How does this contribute to leadership effectiveness in the VUCA world, especially in terms of like its impact on people?
Yeah. So I think emotional intelligence is extremely important because it has far more lasting impact on people. And no matter how much we say, but every person has and feels and experiences a lot of emotions. So emotional intelligence is all about your understanding of emotions and reactions and impact of your words, of your actions and your behaviors on others. So for people, for effective leaders, high level of EI, as we say, is extremely important. Because like I said, you don't operate in isolation. You have a large circle of influence. And if you are not taking the people's emotions or the impact of your, like I said, action, behaviors and words on others, you know, it may sometimes lead to a damaging impact on people. So it is extremely important that as leaders, you're highly self-aware and you consciously work upon building high levels of EI, because like I said, it has a lasting impact on people. They can either feel totally connected to you, and in your tough times, come what may, they will stand beside you. But if they have no emotional connect, the moment they get an opportunity, they'll not even look back at you. So, you know, and in times like this, when there is a constant war of talent, and you need good people beside you to be able to, you know, move things, turn things around, their implicit trust on you, their unflinching commitment towards you and the organization is extremely important. And I have always seen any leader who has demonstrated high EI has always, you know, been able to motivate and drive teams very differently. They will always find their cheerleaders and they will always speak good about their leaders and their organization. And such people also ensure that the culture of the organization is, you know, created in a way that people value each other's views and, you know, gives importance to how they are feeling and their well-being. So, again, that really becomes a part of the culture. And it goes back, Rohit, in ensuring high levels of engagement, high levels of productivity that we were just talking about. And it just makes, and when this is established, people will go all out to support you. So, yes, high EI, emotional intelligence, is extremely important. And leaders need to be self-aware. They need to spend time. They need to do self-reflection because, like I said, they have a large circle of influence. People are listening to them, are observing them. A lot of times they're emulating them. So if you are not following the right practice, it will flow down in your culture. Yeah. It will be reflective in your culture. So, you know, and one wrong behavior if it trickles down to the organization, that will become a wrong precedence, yeah. and that kind of sets the wrong tone. And one right behavior, and when that is emulated, it becomes part of a great culture. So yeah, very important to have a high EQ and be aware of your impact on people.
Thank you, Sulbha. Thanks for coming into this space and sharing your wisdom with us today. And I can see why you are so passionate about this topic. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Rohit. It was so wonderful talking to you about this topic. Personally, like I said, this is something which is very close to my heart. And talking candidly and sharing my thoughts was a wonderful experience. Thank you for giving me the opportunity.
Thanks. Thanks for taking your time out. So, okay, listeners, audience, thanks very much for watching or listening this episode. I'll be back soon with a new guest next week. Till then, take care, stay safe, bye. And don't forget to subscribe to this channel. Please like, share, and subscribe. Thank you very much. Take care. Bye for now.